obedient, gentle and humble, contented, easily supportable with few duties, of light livelihood, controlling senses, discreet, not impudent, not be greedily attached to families. He should not commit any slight wrong such that other wise men might censure him. May all beings be happy. Contented, easily supportable, with few duties. Life, which in Pali is called the Mitra Sutta. He who is skilled in his good and who wishes to attain that state of calm should act thus. He should be able, upright, perfectly upright, obedient, gentle and humble, contented, easily supportable, with few duties, of light livelihood, controlling senses, discreet, not impudent, not be greedily attached to families. He should not commit any slight wrong such that other wise men might censure him. May all beings be happy. Your learned president very kindly invited me to recite the Mitra Sutta, which deals with loving kindness. In fact, I also had the idea of reciting that sutta with the object of radiating thoughts of loving kindness towards the all. In Sydney too I recited that, and you will be pleased to hear that there was pin drop silence. All very attentive to me. So at first I will give you the English translation by me, and then we'll recite in Pali. You please be receptive to me and try to respond to my vibrations. This is the translation of this religious discourse, which in Pali is called the Mitra Sutta. He who is skilled in his good and who wishes to attain that state of calm should act thus. He should be able, upright, perfectly upright, obedient, gentle and humble, contented, easily supportable, with few duties, of light livelihood, controlling senses, discreet, not impudent, not be greedily attached to families. He should not commit any slight wrong such that other wise men might censure him. May all beings be happy and secure. May their minds be wholesome. Whatever living beings there be, feeble or strong, long, stout or medium, short, small or large, seen or unseen, those dwelling far or near, those who are born and those who are to be born, may all beings without exception be happy minded. Let not one deceive another, nor despise any person whatever in any place. In anger or ill will, let him not wish any harm to another. Just as a mother would protect her only child even at the risk of her own life, even so let him cultivate a boundless heart towards all beings. Let his thoughts of boundless loving kindness pervade the whole world, above, below, and across, without any obstruction, without any hatred, without any enmity. Whatever, whether he stands, walks, sits, or lies down, as long as he is awake, he should develop his mindfulness. This, they say, is the highest conduct here. Not falling into error, virtuous and endowed with insight, he gives up attachment to sense desires. Of her truth, he does not come again for conception in her womb. Now this is the Pali Sutta. Karaniya matta kusalena yang tang san tang padang abhisamecca sakko ujuca sujuca suvacho chansa muduvanati mani santuttako ca subharocha appakiccho ca sallauka utti santindriyo ca nipako ca appagabbo kulesu ananugindho nata kundang samachare kinchi yena vinyu pare upavadeyum sukhino va khemino hantu sambe satta bhavantu sukhitatta ekechi pana bhutatthi tasavata virava anavasesa dighavaye mahantava madhimarasaka nukatula dittavaye vadditta yecha dure vasanti avidure bhutava sambhavesiva sambe satta bhavantu sukhitatta neparo param nikumbetha nati manyetha kappatinam kanchi vyarotana patiga sanya nanya manyasa dukkha micchaya mata yatha niyam puttam āyusā eka putta manurakhe evam pi sambha bhūtesu manasaṁ bhāvaye aparimānaṁ mittanta sambha lokasmiṁ manasaṁ bhāvaye aparimānaṁ uddhaṁ adhocha tiriyancha asambhadhaṁ averaṁ asapattaṁ tittaṁ charaṁ nisinnuvā tayāno vāyāvatassa vigatamindu etaṁ satiṁ abhittaya brahma metaṁ viharaṁ idhamāhu dittinca anupagamma sīlavā dassanena sampanno kāmesu vinayya gedhaṁ nahi jātu gabba seyyaṁ sunaretiti. Thank you, sisters and brothers. I am on a Buddhist goodwill mission tour around the world, traveling alone, penniless, provided round the world ticket given by our supporters in Ceylon. I had no idea of visiting Brisbane because no arrangements were made for me to visit Brisbane, although I had the pleasure to visit you all again. When I was in Canberra, I got a message from Mr. Mendick inviting me to Brisbane, and I had the pleasure to accept the invitation and speak to you on 2 days, today and tomorrow. I am grateful to Mr. and Mrs. Mendes for giving me the opportunity to address you tonight. And I am grateful to the Theosophical Society also for offering the platform. Wherever I went, the Theosophical Societies had welcomed me. In Java, most of the lectures were delivered under the auspices of the local Theosophical Societies. I went from place to place, preaching daily from 7:30 to 11:30 p.m. and most of the lectures were given in Theosophical Lodges. In Sydney too, my lectures were given at the Adya Hall. And here I am glad that I am given another opportunity to address you on Buddhism. Tomorrow I will speak on the problems of life and will also give you few practical hints on meditation. I note that many brothers and sisters everywhere, not only in Australia, but in other countries as well, take a great interest in meditation. And meditation is the essence of Buddhism. I remember well, 3 years ago, in this very hall, I gave a lecture on meditation to a large audience. And I think your learned president was present too. After my lecture tomorrow, I shall try to give you a few practical hints. And if this hall is available, we might be able to hold a meditation group, say at about 6 p.m. If you are free, and if the hall is available, I would only be too pleased to give you some practical hints and practice meditation with you. My lecture tonight, as the learned president announced to you, is Buddhism in a nutshell. Here there may be some who are well versed in the Buddha Dhamma. There may be some others who are not so well versed in the teachings of the Buddha. I have to please both parties. In Buddhism you find milk for the baby and meat for the strong. And that is the reason why I decided to speak on Buddhism in a nutshell tonight. Tomorrow I will be speaking on a deep subject, the problems of life. As you all know, precisely 623 years before the birth of Christ, there was born on the Indian borders of Nepal a Sakyan prince named Siddhartha Gautama. He was destined to be the future Buddha Gautama. At the early age of 16, as it was a custom in ancient India, he married his beautiful cousin, Princess Yasodhara. For nearly 13 years, he lived a life of luxury, unmindful of the vicissitudes of life outside his palace gate. With the march of time, truth gradually dawned upon him. He realized the universality of suffering. Although he was not subject to any suffering, he felt pity for suffering humanity. He wanted to find out a panacea for the ills of life. Royal palace was not a congenial place for him. Time was ready for him to depart. Donning the simple garb of an ascetic, as a penniless wanderer, he went forth in search of truth and peace. Sisters and brothers, it was not a case of desertion. It was an unprecedented historic case of renunciation. He renounced not in his old age, but in the prime of youth, not in poverty, but in abundance. As it was the belief in ancient days that no salvation could be gained but by leading a life of strict asceticism, he subjected himself to all forms of austerity. The more he tormented his body, farther the goal receded from him. Finally, he thought of adopting a middle way, via media, which later became one of the chief characteristics of his teaching. One day, seated under the famous Bodhi tree at Gaya, unaided by any supernatural agency, but relying on his efforts and wisdom, at the age of 35, he eradicated all impurities, comprehended the truth, realized things as they truly are, and became an enlightened one, a Buddha. Thereafter he was known as Buddha Gautama. You will see, sisters and brothers, that he was not born a Buddha, but he became a Buddha. Passing through a long course of training in generosity, self-discipline, renunciation, wisdom, energy, patience, truthfulness, firm determination, loving kindness, and equanimity, he became a Buddha. Having attained Buddhahood, he did not claim the monopoly of Buddhahood. He did not say that he was the only Buddha. He advised his disciples to emulate him. In one sense, we are all potential Buddhas. I am a potential Buddha. Your president is a potential Buddha. You all are potential Buddhas. Buddhahood is latent in us all. It is not the prerogative of any specially graced person. One who aspires to become a Buddha is called a Bodhisattva, which means a wisdom being. You will be pleased to hear that Saint Joseph is a corruption of the Sanskrit term Bodhisattva. In Arabic, Bodhisattva becomes Yudhasat. In English, Josephat, not St. Joseph's place. So St. Josephat is a corruption of the Sanskrit term Bodhisattva. Buddha was not a savior place. He cannot save us by his salvation or by his purification. The Buddha says, we are religious teachers, spiritual teachers. You yourself should make the exertion. The Buddhas are mere teachers, but we ourselves should make the exertion. Both purity and impurity depend on ourselves. One can neither purify nor defile another. Both purity and impurity depend on ourselves. So Buddhas are merely teachers, please. Salvation that depends on another is negative, but salvation that depends on oneself is positive. And we must understand that Buddha was a man. He was not a god. He was not a prophet. He was a man, but an extraordinary man, a wonderful man. As a man he was born, as a wonderful man he lived, and as a Buddha he passed away. Although he is not a god, it should be said, there was no spiritual teacher. So god-like as the Buddha, and so godless as the Buddha. As Bertrand Russell says, Buddha was the greatest atheist of all time. Fortunately, there is no deification with regard to the Buddha. Having attained Buddhahood at the age of 35, he came forward to work for humanity as the perfect embodiment of all the virtues he preached. He worked for 45 years for the good and happiness of all, without being dominated by any personal motive whatsoever. He preached his first discourse to 5 disciples. The first discourse is known as the Dhammacakka Sutta, the discourse on righteousness, or the wheel of righteousness. With these 5 disciples as the nucleus, he formed a celibate order, and that celibate order is known as the Sangha. And I should say, this celibate order is the oldest historic noble order, and this order is democratic in constitution and communistic in distribution. Please do not misunderstand me when I say that his order is communistic in distribution. Suppose, for instance, you give something to the Sangha, to the order. We cannot do whatever we like. We have to distribute equally amongst the members of the Sangha. But if you give anything to me in particular, I can do whatever I like. If you give to the Sangha, I cannot do whatever I like. I must distribute equally amongst the members of the Sangha. And that is the reason why I said this order is communistic in distribution. And that distribution is not by force, please. It is a voluntary distribution. Having founded this order, and when there were about 60 arahats of perfect saints, he advised them to go forth to preach this doctrine, which was excellent in the beginning, excellent in the middle, excellent in the end. Go forth, O bhikkhus, he said, for the good and happiness of the many. Preach the Dhamma sublime for the happiness of all. So sending forth missionaries, he also went forth to preach the doctrine to the people. And he addressed his message both to the masses and the intelligentsia. Having established an order for monks, for bhikkhus, he established another order for women too. And that is known as the Bhikkhuni order. For 45 long years, he worked for humanity. And as he was about to die, he advised his disciples to regard his doctrine as their teacher. He said, O disciples, do not think that you have no teacher after my death. Regard the Dhamma I have taught you as your teacher. He who sees the Dhamma, the truth, sees me, the Buddha said. Now may I put a question to you, sisters and brothers. Can we see the Buddha today? How do you answer that question, please? Yes? We can see the Buddha today. You are seeing the Buddha today. Because you are seeing the truth, seeing the Dhamma. I see the Buddha today. I am preaching the Dhamma to you. So we can see the Buddha today. That's why the Buddha said, he who sees the Dhamma sees the Buddha. So he who sees the truth sees the Buddha. Even today we can see the Buddha. At the age of 80, he passed away. When H.G. Wells was asked to mention 6 great names according to order, he gave the first place to Jesus Christ and the 4th place to the Buddha. 10 years later, when he was asked the same question, He gave the first place to the Buddha and the fourth place to Jesus Christ. Faustball, a Danish philosopher, says, "The more I think of the Buddha, the more I love him." A humble fellow like myself would say, "The more I think of the Buddha, the more I love him. The more I love him, the more I know him." The teaching expounded by the Buddha is popularly known as Buddhism. What is Buddhism now? Is it a religion? Is it a philosophy? Is it an ethical system? If by religion is meant a system of faith and worship, owing an allegiance to a supernatural being, Buddhism is not a religion. There is no blind faith in Buddhism. Blind faith is dethroned in Buddhism and is substituted by confidence based on knowledge. You will be pleased to hear that during its peaceful march of 2,501 years, not a drop of blood was shed in the cause of Buddhism. Because Buddhism is not based on blind faith. Buddha advises his disciples to exercise their reasoning and not to accept anything on blind faith. One day he visited a certain place and many Brahmins came to him and said, "Lord, many religious teachers came this way and asked us to embrace their teaching, but we did not want to embrace their teaching." "You are right, O Brahmins. Do not accept anything just because the others say so. Do not accept anything just because the tradition is so. Do not accept anything just because it accords with your scriptures. Exercise your own reasoning. If it appears to you, you may accept it, but not otherwise. If it is conducive to your happiness and to the happiness of others, you may accept. If it is not conducive to your happiness and to the happiness of others, you may reject. Exercise your own reasoning," the Buddha said. On another occasion, a millionaire came to him and was so pleased with the answers given by the Buddha. He said, "Lord, please regard me as one of your followers." Then the Buddha said, "Oh no, don't be in a hurry. What will not the people say? These millionaires renounce their form of faith and embrace the teachings of others. Investigate further. And if it appeals to you, you may accept." Then he said, "Lord, if I had been a follower of another religion, those religious teachers would take me round in a procession saying that such a millionaire had become a follower of theirs. But you cautioned me to think, more pleased am I with that remark of yours. For the second time, Lord, please regard me as one of your followers." See the tolerance of Buddhism says. So there is no blind faith in Buddhism. And there is no worship in Buddhism too. Please do not regard that Buddhists are idol worshippers. We are not idol worshippers. We do not worship an idol. But you may question me. Buddhists worship images. We do not worship images, please. We only pay our respect to what that image represents. Our respect to what that image represents, please. We are not worshipping the images. And when we offer flowers to the image, we reflect on the virtues of the Buddha and meditate on the transiency of life, changeableness of life. But we ask no favors from the Buddha. You respect your flag. It's merely a piece of cloth or paper. But you are not respecting that piece of paper or cloth. You are only venerating your national symbol. In the same way, sisters and brothers, we are only paying our respect to what that image represents. And an intellectual person can gain inspiration from his noble example with an image or without an image. But with regard to the images, I may say, Count Keiseling, a German philosopher, says, "I see nothing more grand in this world than the image of the Buddha. It is the perfect embodiment of spirituality in the visible domain. A German philosopher says about images, place. And we have no prayers, place. No petitional prayers. Instead of petitional prayers, we have meditation. A meditation which leads to self-purification, self-control, self-conquest, and self-enlightenment. It is not a silent reverie, but is an energetic striving. It is a tonic both to the heart and to the mind. Meditation is not seeing colors, please, or seeing visions. It is a mental striving. It leads to enlightenment. I'll speak on that subject tomorrow, and I'm very pleased to tell you that in Australia I came across many spiritually advanced sisters and brothers. Before I went to England, I thought that Europe was very materialistic. But I had to change my view when I visited England for the second time. There are many who are really spiritually advanced, many taking an interest in meditation, and some are psychic too. This time in Melbourne I came across some people who are psychic and who can even see the aura. Some who could remember past births also. And in Brisbane too there may be many who are really spiritually advanced. They do not come to the limelight. They wish to live in seclusion. Science will give us all sorts of pleasures. But can science give us that peace of mind, please? It is meditation that gives that peace of mind. So instead of petitional prayers, we find meditation in Buddhism. And I must say, pardon me, there is no God in Buddhism. Buddha did not place an almighty being over man. He showed us the creative possibilities of man. He was an atheist. We Buddhists are atheists. That does not mean that we are irreligious, please. Our atheism is very often identified with irreligiousness. No, we Buddhists are atheists. Do not believe in a God creator, but we are not irreligious. We are religious. And you will be pleased to hear that the cultural advancement of all the Buddhist nations is due to the benign influence of the teachings of the Buddha. Almost all Buddhist nations grew up in the cradle of Buddhism. So it's not right to say that Buddhists are irreligious, although they do not believe in a God. By all means, believe in that God creator. So no disputes, please. It's left to you. If it is beneficial to you, by all means believe in that God creator. But as Buddhists, we do not believe in a God creator. And we can better ourselves without believing in a God creator. According to Buddhism, we are our own creators. We are our own destroyers. We create our heavens. We create our hells. There may be hell here itself. There may be heaven here itself. If my talk is not interesting to you, you will be in hell here. And after the lecture, with a sigh of relief, you may say, escape from hell. But if my talk is interesting to you, you will not feel that time is fleeting even. One day a young man with a sword in hand came to his professor and said, you must show me heaven and hell to my face, otherwise I will kill you. So the professor ran through fear. The young man chased him with sword in hand. He ran through fear. Where there is fear, there is suffering. No happiness. Now the professor stopped and said, well, here is hell. they follow me, please. No happiness. Where there is suffering, there is hell. The young man understood. He threw the sword aside. Well, here is heaven. No suffering now, no pain, happiness. So where there is happiness, there is heaven. Where there is suffering, there is hell. So we create our own heaven. We create our own hell. We are responsible for our own actions. We are the architects of our own fate. In fact, sisters and brothers, the worm is within us. The brute is within us. Man is within us. God is within us. Brahma is within us. Everything is within us. Both criminality and sainthood are within us, are dormant in us. And that is the reason why the Buddha does not condemn any person. The Buddha says we are all pure at conception. Later, due to adventitious passions, we get defiled. Why should we condemn a person? I put a question to you, sisters and brothers. Please hands up those who are 100% good here. None. 100% bad? None, please. There is good in the worst of us, and there is bad in the best of us. None 100% good. So why should we condemn others? That's why the Buddha said we are all pure at conception. And we all can attain that state of perfection if we are fit for it. So Buddhism, strictly speaking, is not a religion. But if by religion you mean a system to get rid of the ills of life, then surely Buddhism is a religion of religions. Is Buddhism a philosophy? As you all know, philosophy means the love of and search after wisdom. It has nothing to do with practice. Philosophy deals with speculations and theories, which are accepted as gospel truth today, to be thrown overboard tomorrow. Buddha is not concerned with speculations and theories, only with truths and facts that could be tested and verified by experience. But at the same time, it must be remarked that the Buddha has foretold many a philosopher in the West. He anticipated many a philosopher in the West. Heraclitus, as you know, spoke about becoming. Everything is changing. It was he who for the first time said that you cannot step into the same stream twice. The Buddha propounded that doctrine of change 2500 years ago when he was journeying in the valley of the Ganges. You cannot strike the identical place twice. Apparently, yes, I have struck the identical place. No, strictly speaking, you have not struck the identical place twice. So soon matter changes, finger changes, time changes, space changes. Everything is constantly changing, not remaining for two consecutive moments the same. Pythagoras taught the doctrine of the transmigration of souls. Buddhists do not believe in the transmigration of souls, but we believe in the doctrine of rebirth, coming into birth again and again. We do not say that this is the only life between two eternities of heaven and hell. This is made the present. We believe in a series of births in the past and future series too. This is made the present. We are living in the present. We believe in the rebirth, coming into birth again and again. Descartes advised us to use our reasoning. The Buddha advised us to exercise our reasoning before we accept anything on faith. Bhagavan refers to intuitive wisdom, intuitive knowledge. We have intuitive wisdom. Professor James says, if you were to ask me who thinks, I would seem to say thoughts themselves are the thinkers. Now this is a very delicate point, please. If you were to ask me who thinks, I would seem to say thoughts themselves are the thinkers. Why? Because there is no soul here, no entity here. There is merely a thinking. The Buddha says, there is merely a doing but no doer, merely an action but no actor. Preposterous, you may say. Just think of it, please. I say, I see the light. I say, I see the light. We have to use conventional terms. But do I see the light, please? There is merely a perception. Consciousness sees the light through the eye. Eye is merely an instrument. It is a consciousness that perceives the light. So when these three things are combined, we get a perception. So there is merely a perception, but no perceiver. That's why Professor James said, if you were to ask me who thinks, I would seem to say thoughts themselves are the thinkers. A very delicate point too. And we must say that the Buddha did not teach all he knew. He only taught us that which is necessary for our emancipation. One day as he was passing through a forest, he took a handful of leaves and then questioned the bhikkhus, "O disciples, which is greater, the amount of leaves in my hand or the amount of leaves in the forest?" "Lord, the amount of leaves in the forest." "In the same way, O bhikkhus, what I have taught you is comparable to the amount of leaves in my hand. What I have not taught you is comparable to the amount of leaves in the forest. I have taught you only that which is necessary for your emancipation." So you see, Buddhism, strictly speaking, is not a mere philosophy, because Buddhism emphasizes the importance of practice. One day as the Buddha was about to pass away, many monks came to pay their respects to him. But one bhikkhu did not come. He was summoned to his presence. "Is it true that he did not come to pay respect to me?" "Yes, Lord." "Why?" "Because I knew that 3 months hence he would pass away. And I thought the best way to pay my respects to you is not by coming and saluting you like this, but by retiring to myself, meditate, and attain arahatship or sainthood before you pass away." The Buddha said, "Excellent, excellent. He who practices my teaching best reveres me best." The Buddha expects not so much obeisance from his disciples as the actual observance of his teaching. So strictly speaking, Buddhism is not a mere philosophy. Is it then an ethical system? Yes, in Buddhism you find an excellent code of morals, adaptable to all climes and ages. But morality is merely the preliminary stage in Buddhism. It is the ABC of Buddhism. It is not an end in itself. It is only a means to an end. So what is Buddhism now? Well, you can say it's a moral and philosophical system. It's an ethico-philosophical system. It is the Dhamma. We use the term Dhamma, please. It's not a revealed religion. Now, revealed religions claim the monopoly of truth. Buddhism is not a revealed religion. It's the Dhamma, the truth. What is truth now? It's that which is. That is the Dhamma. Or in Sanskrit, Dharma. It is the path of enlightenment. It is the means of deliverance from the ills of life. It is the doctrine of actuality. Or in other words, it is the middle way. It is not a metaphysical path, nor a ritualistic path. It is not skepticism, nor dogmatism. It is not eternalism, nor nihilism. It's the middle way, the middle path, avoiding the two extremes of self-mortification and self-indulgence. Buddhism is based on four noble truths that could be tested and verified by experience. First truth is suffering. There is suffering in this world. And there is a cause to this suffering, the Buddha said. He diagnosed the case, suffering and the cause of suffering. The cause of suffering is craving. As long as there is craving, there is suffering. Or you can say lust or attachment. See, attachment for power, attachment for a piece of earth. See what is happening today? The most precious thing, life on earth, is sacrificed at the altar of brute force. Atom bombs and H-bombs that rain from heaven above are obsolete today. There will be more bombs according to the English alphabet. Some scientists are prostituting science to bring disaster to millions. What is the cause of all these things? Maybe lust for power, lust for a piece of earth, lust for prestige. Is it not craving? As long as there is craving, there is suffering. And wherever I go, well, I give a message, please. We all should try, irrespective of our religious beliefs, to practice our religious principles. According to Christianity, there is neighborliness. Both according to Christianity and Judaism, neighborliness. Love thy neighbor as thyself. According to Hinduism, ahimsa, non-violence. According to Buddhism, loving kindness towards all. Practice their neighborliness. Hindus, their non-violence. Buddhists, their loving kindness. And Muslims, their brotherhood. There will be peace on earth. It's left to the theosophical societies to try their best to combine the scientific knowledge of the West with the spiritual wisdom of the East to evolve a golden era, when all could live in one world, like brothers and sisters, in perfect peace and harmony. That's what we should do today. You may say that the Buddha was a pessimist. If the Buddha had stopped by merely stating there is suffering in this world. No, Buddha did not say that there was merely suffering in this world. He said, well, you can get rid of this suffering. Third truth is end of suffering, which is Nibbana. The fourth truth is a path leading to the cessation of suffering. We find four truths. Now the first truth of suffering is to be analyzed and investigated. The second truth, craving, is to be eradicated. Third truth, Nibbana, is to be realized. And the fourth truth, the Noble Eightfold Path, is to be developed. As I said, these four truths can be verified by experience. Hence, there is no blind faith, no coercion, no compulsion. Buddha did not even use the command, the imperative, thou shalt not. Buddha simply said, it behoves you not to do this. It is tolerance. And that tolerance the Buddha extends to men and women and all living beings. In the time of the Buddha, there was no freedom for all. Outcasts were not allowed even to hear the Veda. The Buddha said, it's not by birth one becomes an outcast. It's not by birth one becomes a noble. It's by actions one becomes an outcast. It's by actions one becomes a noble. And he opened the portals of his order to all deserving ones, irrespective of the caste or class. Scavengers were admitted into the order. Fishermen were admitted into the order. Prostitutes were admitted into the order. He gave complete freedom, equal privileges for all. And then it was the Buddha who granted emancipation to women as well. Before the advent of the Buddha, women were treated with contempt, please. In some Sanskrit verse, it is stated that the women are like lampposts that lead to hell. In another work it is stated, not in a Buddhist book, please, in a Sanskrit verse, another work it is stated, you may believe that there are white crows. There are no white crows. Crows are black. But you may believe that there are white crows. You may believe that there are footprints of fish on sand, but never believe the heart of a woman. I repeat, not in Pali verse or Buddhist verse, please. When I was in Sweden, I gave a lecture in a church hall, Unitarian church hall, and then a question was put to me, how do you account for the problem of evil? I said, yes, a very good question. May I know from you, according to your scriptures, who is responsible for all the evil in this world? The lecture was under the auspices of the local Theosophical Society, and the lady was presiding. And she at once said, Mother Eva. Mother, they say Eva, not Eve. I say, Mother Eva is responsible for all the evil in this world. Then I said, it's not I who am telling you that, your own president. I said, isn't this an insult to motherhood? They all shouted, you are right. Isn't that an insult to motherhood, please? Yes. There you are. Now what does the Buddha say? The Buddha says, there is a ladder which enables you to ascend to heaven. And what is that ladder? Mother. In Buddhism, women are regarded as mothers, please. In some places, the term used for women is matugama, which means mother folk. And it was the Buddha who, for the first time in the history of the world, established a society with rules and regulations for women. And that is the order of nuns, the Bhikkhuni order. And in the order of monks, you find two chief disciples, like Sariputta and Moggallana. In the order of nuns also, you find two chief disciples, Kema and Uppalavanna. One day, the Buddha was conversing with a king, and the messenger came and said, Your Majesty, a daughter is born unto you. And he was displeased. The Buddha saw him. Why are you displeased, Your Majesty? I understand that a daughter is born unto me. No, Your Majesty, think not thus. The Buddha said, Some women may even excel men. Some women, the Buddha said, may even excel men. So bring up that daughter then. So no other religious teacher has made such a remark. The Buddha granted emancipation to women too. And he raised them to the highest pedestal. And the Buddha did not forget children too. There are many religious discourses which have been preached to children. And it was he who tried to ban sacrifice of animals. He said, we must show our loving kindness towards all, even to the living, even to animals. We should regard them as our brothers and sisters, have compassion on the poor animals. It was he who tried his best to ban sacrifice of animals too. And the Buddhism is based on this loving kindness, please. And that is one of the chief teachings of Buddhism. We should not, on account of our religious beliefs, be confined to watertight compartments. If on account of our religious beliefs we cannot meet in a common platform like brothers and sisters, then surely the missions of all the religious teachers have failed. We may have our own beliefs, but through loving kindness we all must be united. And that is the best thing to be done on earth. A true Buddhist is an is a citizen of the world. He regards all as his brothers and sisters. Last time when I was in Australia, over the radio, they put a question to me. Do you like Australia? I said, yes. I regard the whole world as my motherland and all as my brothers and sisters. Then he said, you don't find rivers and mountains in Australia as you find Ceylon? If I do not see the ugliness in others, I try to see the good and beautiful in all. Let us try to see the good and beautiful in all places, not the ugliness in others. Through loving kindness, we all must be united. In Buddhism, you find two chief doctrines. The doctrine of come and rebirth. What's the time, please? I have no watch with me, pardon? 9 o'clock. Oh. I've spoken for 1 hour, is it? Uh-huh. What do you suggest, please, now?
Did you go?
I'm not boring you?
No. I'm happy to understand and have a cup of tea later on, so you can just go on.
Now, how do you account for the inequality of mankind, please? This is an unbalanced world. Even between twins who are physically alike, there is a great difference. Physically they are alike, but mentally, intellectually and spiritually they differ. How do you account for this inequality of mankind? Well, some say it is due to the work of a God creator. And we leave that question alone, left to you. You try to argue, discuss this matter. Tomorrow I shall deal with that question. What do scientists say? Scientists say it is due to the nature and nurture. The nature and nurture. And they tell us at the moment of birth, we inherit from our parents an infinitesimally small cell, about 120th part of an inch across. We admit that. And that is the physical foundation of man. Well, how do scientists account for the dissimilarities? Scientists can account for similarities. The law of heredity can account for similarities, but not for dissimilarities. Even in this hall, you do not find two persons who are alike. There's a great difference. So Buddhism says there are several causes for this difference. Not only nature and nurture, the environment, upbringing, education, so many causes. And there is a still greater cause, and that is the karma or karma, action. According to Buddhism, for the production of the fetus, not only the sperm cell and the ovum cells are necessary, another factor is necessary. And that is the consciousness. And this consciousness is conditioned by our past actions. As our past actions differ, there is a difference amongst individuals. As all the physical characteristics of our parents, grandparents, are embedded in this infinitesimally small cell, even so, all the past impressions are indelibly recorded in this consciousness of ours. All the past impressions, indelibly recorded, please. They're not lost. And sometimes they come to the surface at unexpected moments in disconcerting strength. And that is the reason why some children sometimes do remember fragments of their past birth, because they are embedded in the consciousness, they are recorded in the consciousness. I remember I was giving you lecture last time here. Unexpectedly the thought came to me now. I was standing here, not seated here. I was seated and there was a large audience. Wasn't it so? Eh? Very large audience, and I spoke on meditation. I just remembered it. Why? Because the picture is there. It's recorded in my consciousness. And that is the best picture, the best history. So we do have to say that everything is due to nature and nurture, and also everything is not due to karma. Karma is only one cause, many causes play. But karma is very important. What is karma now, or karma? It is the law of moral causation. Law of moral causation, or the cause and effect, whereas the Westerners say, action influence. Action influence, they say. Good begets good. Evil begets evil. Like attracts like, that is karma. The Bible says, as thou sowest, thou shalt reap. We find the actual words in Pali. Yadisam vapate bijam, sadisam harate phalam. Yadisam vapate bijam, as you sow. Sadisam harate phalam, so you reap. We reap what we have sown. What we sow, we reap somewhere or some wind. We are the architects of our own fate. We are responsible for our own action. We are our own creators and we are our own destroyers. In one sense, we are what we were. We will be what we are. In another sense, we are not what we were and we will not be what we are. Did I make myself clear to you, please? No. I'll explain. Some understood. We are what we were. We will be what we are. The present is conditioned by the past. And the future is conditioned by the present. The present is the offspring of the past. And in turn it becomes the parent of the future. So the present is conditioned by the past, and the present conditions the future. So in one sense, we are what we were, we will be what we are. If I had been a criminal yesterday, I would be a criminal today. And if I am a criminal today, I may be a criminal tomorrow, in one sense. And then there is another sense. We can use our free will. We can mold our life. It's left to us. Yesterday I may be a criminal. Today I may be a saint. We are not what we were then. Today I may be a criminal. Tomorrow I may be a saint. So we will not be what we are. So in one sense, we are what we were. We will be what we are. In another sense, we are not what we were. We will not be what we are. Did I make myself clear to you, please? That's an important thing. And that's why we say we can exercise our free will. Tomorrow I'll deal with that subject also. If we are free will, so everything predestined. There is free will to some extent. We are very often determined by our past actions, by the environment, and by many causes. But at the same time we can use our free will too. Suppose, for instance, you are climbing up a hill. Well, you can use your free will. You can climb as you like. But you are falling from a hill. If you are falling from the hill, you cannot use your free will. You will fall to the ground just as an inanimate stone would. You cannot use your free will there. But you can use the free will at times. I will deal with that question later. So karma is not predestination, please. It's not fate. It's not fatalism. We are neither the masters of our karma nor the servants of karma. And as long as there is karma, there is rebirth, coming into birth again and again. We see the light here. The light is merely the outward manifestation of the invisible electric energy. The bulb may break. The light may be extinguished. But the energy is not lost. So we can produce the light in another bulb. In the same way, although the body disintegrates, the karmic energy is not lost. We all are the outward manifestations of this invisible karmic energy. What is death now, please? It's merely the temporary end of a temporary phenomenon. Temporary end, please. Temporary end of a temporary phenomenon. Death here means birth in another place. Birth in one place means death in another place. Birth precedes death and death precedes birth. With that question also I'll deal tomorrow. When I answer the question when, from where have we come? Can we prove this doctrine of rebirth experimentally, please, now?